Good morning, church.
Good morning.
They asked me if I brought a handout today, and I said, well, if everybody brought their Bibles, we've got the best handout there is. We're going to be discussing the concept of faith and works in Bible class today. It is a very necessary discussion. This is a topic and a discussion we need to be well equipped to have. And I think as we travel through this, you'll understand. This is a very valuable discussion. I need someone who's comfortable reading aloud from the Bible. Okay? If you would turn to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. And nice and loud, read for everyone Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 9. Thank you. Tell me your name, dear. Miss Brandy. Thank you very much. You did well. Very good. All right. So this passage, Ephesians 2, 8 through 9, is oft misunderstood and just as often is taken out of context and misapplied. It causes a lot of difficulty in the discussion of salvation. A lot of times, people will say after reading this verse, if you did anything in receiving your salvation, if you did anything at all, then you did wrong. That is usually directed and aimed at the discussion regarding baptism. When people talk about doing anything, it's about the discussion of baptism. And the response is usually for the Christian to quote many other verses in the Bible, like Mark 16:16. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, he who believeth not shall be condemned. We might quote Acts 2:38. Peter said unto them, right after they'd been stricken to the depths of their souls and cried out, men and brethren, what shall we do? They wanted to fix their situation, and Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We'll quote that verse. Or we might quote one of my favorites, 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 21. Corresponding to that, baptism now saves you, not the removal of the dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. First of all, and this is just an aside, and it's something you don't, I'm not going to charge you any extra for. The answer to the discussion of baptism in salvation, I don't want to sow any seeds of doubt there. I don't want anyone to go, well, what's the answer to that? So here's the answer. There are two elements about the point of salvation. Two elements that are included in that. One is what we would refer to as causal. The cause, the force behind our salvation, and the other is temporal, related to time of our salvation. Baptism is the temporal element in salvation. That is the time at which we go from being lost to being saved, is baptism. The causal element is grace. And the reason that's important to know is anytime you have a discussion with someone that wants to downplay the importance of baptism, they'll go to grace every time. Well, grace saves you. It's not of yourselves. Grace saves you. So, in a discussion like that, where someone might say something like that to you, you could say, I agree with you 100%. Grace is the force behind our salvation. And while they drop everything and try to pick it up because they're so shocked, you then say, baptism is the time at which God's grace is extended. And that is the truth. That will handle that discussion and get it going the right direction. So understand that, and that's just as an aside. There is a truth we must remember. 1 Corinthians 14:33, does anyone know it? God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. The reason that's important is that many people will be having a religious discussion, and they'll try to pull out one verse or another in a combative sense against a verse that you might bring up. That doesn't work. Because God is not a God of confusion, He's a God of peace. And by peace, it means concord. It means an agreement between persons, union in opinions or sentiments, views or interests. That's from Webster's 1828 dictionary. God is a God where everything agrees. Everything He puts out agrees with itself. So if we start combating and trying to say, well, this verse says this and this verse contradicts that verse, that's not going to work. So our natural instinct to talk about salvation and combat verses that other people might bring up, we don't want to go that way. The Bible always agrees with itself. So we need to look at all of the verses involved, specifically the first one that we had read. And we need to understand them properly so that they agree with one another. 2 Peter 1, 20 and 21 also supports that. But know this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation. Let me say that again. No prophecy of Scripture is of one's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. There's one way to understand Scripture. Just one way. There is no, well, that's your view and this is my view and we'll all hold hands and sing Kumbaya and be fine. There's one way to understand what the Bible says. The application is, as I've said, we can't pit one Scripture against another. God intended and communicated one message. So the outcome is that we're going to look at three passages this morning. We've had Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10 read. We're going to look at Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, and James 2, 18 through 24, which I don't know. Anybody ever read anything by Martin Luther? Martin Luther was the founder of the Lutheran faith, and Martin Luther didn't like the book of James, largely because he dealt with the problem we're about to deal with, and he couldn't make sense of it. So he called James a right straw epistle. He didn't appreciate that book of James, but that is God's word. We have to understand God's word correctly if we're going to be God's faithful servants. So first, we want to understand Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, and James 2, 18 through 24, in a harmonious way. So, if somebody would look at Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, when you get there, please read that for us.
What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, has found? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the Scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, his wage is not credited as a favor, but as what is due. But to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness.
Very well read. And that's the version that I like the most. For those of you who don't know, ask. It's a lot of fun to talk about how different versions interact. That's my favorite, but I'm going to leave that mystery up to you. That passage emphasizes that justification before God is not through works, but is through what? Faith. Justification before God is through faith. Somebody, if you would, turn to James chapter 2 and read verses 18 through 24 for us.
You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without the works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one. you do well. The demons also believe and shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, the faith without works is useless? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up Isaac his son on the altar? You see, the faith was working with his works, and as a result of the works, faith was perfected. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, "And Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, and he was called the friend of God." You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone.
Do you see the beginning of the problem that so many Christians face? The passage in Romans seems to say it's all about faith and it's not about works. The passage in James seems to say just the opposite. If we don't understand these correctly, we have an unanswerable problem. If we don't understand these correctly, you might as well take the precious Bible and throw it down the drain. Because here we have God contradicting himself if these passages are not understood correctly. This passage emphasizes that Abraham was justified by works and not by faith alone. So, keep hold of the observation that God does not contradict himself. God is not the author of confusion. There is not my interpretation and your interpretation. There is one interpretation. That's 1 Peter 3:21. I'm sorry, 1, 20 and 21. Here is the proposal, and we're going to explore this during the remainder of our class time. James ensures that we do not misunderstand the Romans passage. Romans 4 is not suggesting that God's grace does not demand a response from humanity. Would you like to see how that works? I'm going, yes. I'm going to make a gift. Where's a youngster? Do we have any youngsters? They're all in Bible class, aren't they? Okay, it doesn't have to be a youngster. Just has to be someone, well, who wants $5. That's what it has to be. I have right here a $5 bill. Who would like this $5 bill? You would like this? The teacher would like it? Okay. Come get it. Come get it. Did I just give her $5? Was it a gift? Did you earn that gift? Did you earn it? Was that worth $5? Okay. The thing that we want to get out of this is that was a gift.
I didn't get that illustration. Could you do it one more time?
Man, this trip's going to cost me. No. The thing that we want to get is that was a gift of $5. To get that gift, she did something. Did she earn it? Or was it a gift? Both of these passages examine the story of Abraham, but they make different points from Genesis chapter 15. So let's consider the following questions about Abraham and his situation from Genesis 15. Was Abraham justified? There are two questions here. One, was Abraham justified without, apart from any relationship with works? Or, and get out your stamp that says authentic in red. Get ready for it. Or, was Abraham justified by faith when he offered Isaac on the altar? justified by faith when he, when did God give him the approval? When did God tell him that it was right? When he offered Isaac on the altar, that's when God said, approved. The thrust or the context of Romans, we're going to have to use this to understand. First of all, did I need her to come and get $5 from me? Did I need her to do that? Could I have walked over there and handed it to her? Could I have kept my $5 and bought some McNuggets this afternoon? I didn't need her to have it. I wanted her to have it. And I didn't need her to come get it. But those were the conditions that I set for her to receive the gift. Did God need Isaac to die? Of course not. There's no way that would benefit God. God didn't need that. Did God even need Abraham? Let's go further with it. Did God even need the nation of Israel? Remember, at one point God said, "Stand back, I'm going to wipe them all out. I'll start all over with you." God didn't need them. Did Abraham do anything that indebted God to give the promises to Abraham that he did? No. No, he did not. So let's understand some context now. Romans chapters 1 through 3 convicts both Jews and Gentiles of sin. If you recall reading Romans 1 through 3, it's a discussion about how humanity has fallen short. Romans 3 gives special attention to convicting the Jews that they are just as guilty and just as in need of God's saving grace as the Gentiles. Just as in need of Jesus as the Gentiles. That's what Romans 3 emphasizes. It drives it home. By the way, there's a fun thing. I don't know if you all have italics in your version or not. But one of the fun things, one of the necessary things about a minister examining original language, right? Got to be able to do it. In Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 20, there is a discussion about the law. Chapter 3, verse 19, the law being the Old Testament law. Chapter 3, verse 19, talks about the law. Chapter 3, verse 20. Somebody read Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Read verse 19 and 20, if you would.
Whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law.
The law. The law. Do you hear it?
That every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the works of the law...
That's verse 20.
Yes.
By the works of the law.
But in his sight, for through the law comes knowledge of sin.
Okay, thank you. Verse 19, if you look at the original language, the law is actually what it says. There is a definite article there in the Greek language, the law. Verse 20, you start looking at it, and though verse 20 records it as the law, our translators did not do us a favor there because there is no definite article. It should just record law. Paul, in writing Romans, makes a distinction between the law, being the Old Testament law, and then law, as in a system of law keeping. A system of law keeping to earn credit. A system of law keeping to earn reward. A system of law keeping to indebt the lawmaker to you. And that's the issue that the Jews faced. They believed that if they gave enough alms, if they did enough good deeds, if they worshiped and prayed hard enough, that they could then stand before God with their hand out saying, "Pay me what you owe me." That is law, a system of law keeping. And what that passage says is that doesn't work. This is the Jewish mind. And that's why Paul is spending more time talking to them about this. You cannot earn your salvation by a system of law keeping, which is what you Jews have tried to do for generations. Can't do it. You need Christ just as much as the Gentiles need Christ. Sorry to spoil your party. That's what Paul is doing in Romans in that discussion. Romans 3:28, man is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. What's the major drawback about a system of law keeping? In a system of law keeping, how many mistakes do you get before you're condemned? Just one. Just one. Matter of fact, Romans 3:23 says so, if you recall. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I saw that tattooed on a lady's arm, Romans 3:23. And I said, "Really? Romans 3:23. She said, "Yep, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." She got that tattoo to point out that everybody else was just like her and they had no right to tell her that she was sinful and was condemned. And I said, "Have you read Romans 6:23? The 23s is what gets you. Have you read Romans 6:23? And she said, "No." And I said, "It says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." This is a discussion for the Jews about the wages, what they have earned. And they had this mindset that because we're such good people, we've earned salvation. And Paul says, "No. No, the only thing you've earned is death because you haven't kept the law perfectly." A system of law keeping then does not work. Somebody read Galatians 3:19, please. And somebody else go to Hebrews 10. That's a heavy verse. The thing I want us to get from that is, what was the purpose of the law? What was its function? What did it do according to Galatians 3:19? We had Christ come after the law. But according to Galatians 3:19, the law only marked transgressions. That was its function. That's why the law was added, because of transgressions. That was the function of the law. Who has Hebrews chapter 10 for us? We need Hebrews 10, 1 through 4, if you would, please.
"For the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come and not the very form of things, can never buy the same sacrifices year by year, which they offer continually, make perfect those who draw near. Mm. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, because the worshipers have once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sin? But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins year by year."
There's a what?
"There is a reminder of sins year by year."
The function of the sacrifices was never to take away sin. It was never to forgive sin. That didn't happen under the law. According to Galatians 3, the law was there to mark out transgressions, to show the transgressions. Hebrews chapter 10 tells us the law never forgave sin. Sacrifices never forgave sin. Sacrifices highlighted it. It was a reminder of sin. It never forgave. With this discussion on our minds, the first three chapters of Romans, we then come to Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. What had Abraham found? In context, he did not have justification by works. By the way, justified. You ever heard what justified? Easy way to remember justified. Yeah. I'm justified before God. I'm treated and viewed as a perfect 10 before Him. That's what justification means. But you can remember it, and some of you all do, very well by saying, it makes me, in God's eyes, just as if I'd never sinned. He didn't have that state by works, being works of law. You understand, that's the discussion in Romans. His works of law-keeping did not make him justified just as if he had never sinned before God. Matter of fact, it did the opposite. So all of your works of law have only highlighted your sin. He wasn't justified that way. It couldn't and still can't be done. A system of law-keeping does not justify us before God. One of the first theological discussions I ever had, a wise man asked the Bible class, how do you feel about your status before God? And I thought, well, I feel pretty good. I've been trying really hard lately. There's the problem. I thought, because I've been trying really hard, because I'm making new efforts to please God, I'm trying to grow in how I please God, that I'm pleasing Him. That I'm earning some credit. Well, my efforts didn't save me. The law keeping doesn't save us. The law of Moses doesn't save us. Genesis 15:6, the passage that was quoted about Moses, that was before Moses even received the law. Realize that? That was before he was given the law. So he couldn't have been saved by the law. Instead, something was credited to him as righteousness. And it was before the law. He wasn't justified by the law or a system of law keeping. In context, Moses was justified before God. I love that word, justified before God. He was justified before God. Think about the story of Moses. Because he took God at His word and he lived accordingly. That is why Moses was justified before God. James chapter 2, remember I said the account in James, makes sure that we don't misunderstand the account in Romans. James 2 points out that Abraham was justified by faith when he followed through at Moriah. He offered his son, was prepared to kill him. This is when his faith was made. Are you ready for a James word? This is when his faith was made complete. That's when his faith was made perfect, complete, James 2:22. This contrasts against another type of faith in the book of James. Do you know what faith I'm talking about? Who believes? Who has faith and trembles? The demonic faith. The demons believe and tremble. The demons have faith, but their faith causes them to tremble, not to change. And that's the discussion in James. Did you all believe I'd give her a $5 bill? Got out my wallet. I'm not sure if you believed until you had it in your hands. And then you might have been scared I was going to try to take it back. But I got out my wallet. I pulled out a $5 bill, laid it out. You saw that it was there. There was all the evidence that I was going to give it away. I made the proclamation, who wants this $5 bill? And somebody said, I want it. Well, let's think this through. How ridiculous would it have been if I'd have said, well, too bad, you can't have it? That would have been really messed up, right? The only reason for me to get that out and ask who wants it is because I was going to give it away, and that's pretty believable, right? What differentiated her faith in that statement is that she got up out of her chair and she walked up and she took it. Her faith in my statement was made complete. Do you see? That's the discussion of James. And it's opposed to faith only. Does this make sense? Are we grasping this a little bit? Are you ready for some proof? What do y'all know about manna? It appeared on the ground. What else do you know about manna? Oh, it tastes like coriander. I love coriander. I got to cook a steak recently and put some of that on there. Man, had a nice flavor to it. What else do you know about manna? It came from God. It was a gift of God, a gift from God. It appeared every day except for the day before the Sabbath. Well, except on the Sabbath. It appeared the day before the Sabbath, and twice as much appeared so that they wouldn't have to break the Sabbath in gathering it. Wait, was manna a gift from God? God provided it for them at no cost. It was a free gift. But what did they have to do to get it? Get out of your chair, come get the $5 bill. They had to go pick it up off the ground. Did they earn their manna by doing that, or was it still a gift from God? Are you ready for more proof? How about Canaan land? Particularly the city of Jericho. Let's talk about that. What did they do to conquer Jericho? First of all, who conquered Jericho? Please? Who conquered Jericho? Thank you. To whom did he give the city of Jericho? He gave it to his people, didn't he? He gave them the victory. What did they do in order to get the victory? March around that city. Last day, march around it more. Sound the trumpets. And then what happened? The walls fell down. The walls fell inward. They what? They did. How do you know? The evidence of their faith was their actions. But it wasn't that they earned the victory over Jericho. God gave it to them. But he required actions to receive that gift, did he not? Let's talk about another one that's kind of fun. How about Naaman? You remember Naaman? He showed up and he asked for help. And the prophet of God told him, go dip in the Jordan 7 times. And what was his response? Was the Jordan nice? Was it appealing? Did you want to go for a swim in the Jordan? No. He said, there are better rivers back home. I don't want to go in. And he got upset. It wasn't that he asked him to go and do something desirable even. But how many times had Naaman gotten wet in his life? How many folks took a shower? Don't tell me. I don't want to know if you didn't shower this morning. That could be a mistake having that discussion. But Right, getting out of the car, we all had a shower. The point is, Naaman had gotten wet like that several times in his life, and his leprosy still remained. Did he earn the cure for his leprosy by dipping in the Jordan seven times? No. Was it still a gift from God? Yes. Matter of fact, he tried to pay for it, didn't he? And the prophet of God, who understood faith and works, evidently, said, "Nope, I don't want it." A foolish servant of the prophet, who didn't understand, went and said, "Give it to me." And he got what Naaman had. The point is, God supplied gifts throughout the history of the Bible, throughout the history of humanity. He supplied gifts, and there were conditions on receiving the gifts, were there not? And nobody in their right mind would ever think to say, "I earned that gift from God." They all understood, every account that we just talked about, they all understood it was a gift from God, and they never would have claimed to have earned it. How about the principle of gift giving today? We understand gift giving today. If it were closer to Christmas, we really would. Is there a Chick-fil-A here in town? There is? How about I treat everybody to lunch today? No, all y'all know that joke. That appears at least once a year on the internet, you know, on a Sunday. Father's Day, free Chick-fil-A for all the fathers. Yeah. But if Chick-fil-A puts out an advertisement that says, "We're giving away sandwiches. Everybody who walks in the door gets a free sandwich." Can you sit at your house and get a free sandwich? No, there are conditions on it. If you walk in the door at Chick-fil-A, you get the free sandwich. Nobody in their right mind would ever say, "Boy, I really had a hard time earning that sandwich today." They'd get the free sandwich, come outside munching on that thing, going, "They're giving these away." We understand gift giving. So, here's the question. What does God require of humanity to receive the salvation he so readily dispenses? And would we ever be so ridiculous as to claim that we could earn it? I think we're understanding here. So, back to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9, that was kind of the start of this whole problem. We got, what, 5 minutes? Okay. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9, in light of the discussion we've just had, and helped Romans and James to agree with one another. Ephesians 2 discusses how God unites all humanity in the body of Christ. If you want to look later, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 through 23, chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. There is nothing that humanity could do to earn salvation. That's why the passage we read, it is not of yourselves. It is not as a result of works. You didn't earn it. There's nothing you can do to earn it. And Paul made sure they understood that. So that no one may boast. What would boasting mean? Look what I did. A lot of us came in glad for the rain today. No one came in going, "Look what I did." I think we understand. Nobody could take credit for the rain. Grace is that which God extends to us, which allows us to stand as justified, that perfect 10, just as if I'd never sinned before him. This is the gift. That is the gift of God. Through faith, real faith, enacted faith, that is humanity's part. That is the condition which God places on it. That is God saying, "If you want this $5, you can have it. I'll give it to you. Get up out of your chair and I'll give it to you. Come take it." That's what's going on in this verse. We did not earn it. We did not receive it as wages, as if God owed us. In the discussion of faith, the faith discussed is the real faith, the active faith, the faith that is evident, Remember, James said, show me your faith without your works. I'll show you my faith by my works. He was a little tongue-in-cheek there, but it's impossible to show faith without works. That's what James was saying. Faith that is genuine is evidenced by the works. Note the example of complete faith, perfected faith, finished faith that has arrived at its intended place in the salvation accounts in the New Testament. Acts 2:37, men and brethren, what shall we do? They wanted to know, how can we be saved from all this? And Peter told them. How many were saved on the day of Pentecost? 3,000. Those were people who had real, genuine faith, and they received the gift of salvation from God. Acts 9:5-6, Saul of Tarsus. Get up and enter the city, and it will be told you, just like from the previous verse we discussed, what you must do. Not that Paul was going to earn his faith, not earn his faith, earn his salvation. He wasn't going to earn his salvation. But there was a requirement for what he must do. Acts 16:30, the account of the Philippian jailer. Some people get tripped up by this, by the way. Philippian jailer runs out. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you'll be saved, you and your whole household. He got up, washed their wounds, they preached to him, he was baptized. Then we get confirmation. Having believed, that baptism was there. And that was evidence that he had believed, that his faith was real, and he was saved after that. Not one of the converts in the New Testament would say, I earned my salvation. Every single one of them understood a gift from God, the forgiveness of every sin I've ever committed, every sin I ever will commit. That's a gift, isn't it? The bookkeeper wiped it clean. He blotted it out so it can't be seen anymore. That's a gift. There are conditions on the gift. Every convert understood that, and we need to understand it. So the relationship between faith and works, very quickly. Romans makes sure that we understand we cannot earn our salvation. James makes sure that we understand that when we say we believe, our actions are evidence of it. Otherwise, our faith is not real. It is as useless as a faith of demons. If you didn't have real faith, you wouldn't have $5 right now, would you? But you stood up and took it. That's the difference, and that's what those two accounts are communicating. Ephesians then makes sure that we understand the proper role of all the working parts. God offers a gift, we accept it. While we do not boast in our works, the works are understood to be present. So, never would we claim to have earned our salvation from God. He owes us nothing but death because of our sin, according to Romans 6:23 and 3:23. God offers the gift of salvation to all of humanity. Salvation, just like the $5 bill, comes with a requirement. $5 bill came with a requirement, come get it. Salvation comes with the requirement that we have real, evident faith. I hope that this study has helped. I hope that the notes you got are going to be useful to you and that our understanding has increased between Romans and James and Ephesians, faith and works. Thank you for your time and attention this morning.